Kristina, I want to get into Invesco's mid-year investment outlook, but before we do that, recent news coming out of the U.S. with respect to CPI data for June, higher than expected. Tell us, what is the inflation story now? Has it peaked? Is it moderating? What's the narrative?
Well, my view is that it probably has peaked because we have seen commodity prices coming down, a variety of commodities coming down recently. So I suspect this may very well be the peak. But having said that, I know it's causing concern and it's causing a lot of anxiety because there is the expectation that the Fed will continue to be very aggressive. But I think the key is that it's going to be data dependent. So as we see the data change, we'll see the Fed change.
Does this change your outlook at all, the forecast for the last half of 2022?
No, not at all, because we anticipated inflation peaking around mid-year. It's very hard to divine with precision when that will be, but around mid-year, and that really seems to be what's happening. It of course, does increase the chances that we go into a recession, but we really have thought about that and contemplated that in one of our tail risk scenarios. Again, I still think it is far from a done deal. It's not a fait accompli. We could very well avoid a recession. And in fact, that continues to be my base case for the United States.
Let's talk about inflation expectation. It's coming in at 9.1% in the U.S. Do you expect it to hover somewhere around that 8 to 9%, or maybe even above that 9% for however many months? How long do you expect it to hang around for?
Well, I certainly think inflation is going to remain elevated for some time. I do think we're going to start to see a moderation soon, but it's still going to be very uncomfortable, very elevated levels. And that, of course, is going to create anxiety. It's going to create volatility, not just in equities, but in the bond market. We've seen treasuries go on a roller coaster as a result of that. But again, I think it's to be expected. And the key is that we see directionally that it starts to moderate in the back half of this year.
Let's get into global economies. And I guess specifically from your vantage point, you're in the US, we're here in Canada, both central banks tightening up monetary policy. What does that do to Canada's economy, to the US economy?
Well, it's clearly going to slow down both economies, right? The Bank of Canada, the Fed, they want to cool demand. And that's really the only thing they can do with monetary policy is to tighten financial conditions and cool demand. There are other sources of inflation that they can't control for, and they recognize that. But to the extent they can, they will. Of course, it's a delicate balancing act. And if you are overly aggressive, and central banks don't know that until it's really in their rearview mirror. But if you're overly aggressive, you, of course, can send your respective economies into recession. Now, I am optimistic, very optimistic, that the central banks will pay attention to incoming data. We heard as much from Jay Powell. In fact, in the June FOMC meeting, he talked about how essentially two data points, inflation and inflation expectations, helped tilt the Fed to do a 75 basis point rate hike in June. But that can work the other way as well. If the Fed and the Bank of Canada start to see inflation moderating and they start to see demand cooling enough, they could, in fact, pursue a less aggressive path of tightening.
Do you see any economies around the world rebounding? We had thought that this was going to be the summer of recovery. Instead, we're dealing with interest rate increases and inflation. Do you see anyone, I guess, around the world doing something different than we are?
Absolutely. You know, when we think about China, it was first in terms of the pandemic and first out. Now, of course, it's gone back in and it's gotten worse because of this particular Omicron variant, which has spread quite rapidly and caused significant shutdowns. But China is in a very different position than the US. The U.S.'s central bank is trying to slow down the economy. China is actually trying to stimulate its economy. So the People's Bank of China is providing stimulative monetary policy. It's loosening while Western developed central banks are tightening. China is also providing significant fiscal stimulus. And of course, the economy is reopening right now from these COVID shutdowns. So that is a very different picture than the U.S. A developed country that is behaving quite differently and acting quite differently than Western developed countries is Japan. And we continue to see monetary policy very, very supportive, very loose. They're not getting looser, but they're very loose. That is supportive. And there is some fiscal stimulus in Japan as well. So that is very, very different than what we're seeing in Western developed countries.
You also talk about tail risk scenarios in the report. Tell us about those as you see them playing out for 2022.
Well, the tail risk scenarios are both to the upside and to the downside. So everyone would love to see a de-escalation in Ukraine-Russia tensions. That would be a real positive, particularly for the energy market. So if that situation could be resolved, we could see some increase in growth, and we could see some decrease in inflation. So that would be close to or at the best case scenario we could get in the back half of this year. Now, there is that alternate tail risk scenario that is far worse, and that is an escalation in Russia-Ukraine tensions. And what that, of course, could do is add to energy prices. We're already seeing some forecasts, some concern that oil and gas prices could go up. That would definitely be the case if we had that escalation in tensions. And the epicenter of damage would, of course, be Europe, because Europe is so reliant on Russian energy. That would create an environment of stagflation for Europe, but it wouldn't leave the rest of the world unscathed. We would certainly see headwinds from that, and that would depress growth and increase inflation up for many countries around the world.
Lastly, it is called the investment outlook. So ultimately, when you take into consideration all these elements, global economies, central banks, where do you see markets headed? What do you see in terms of, growth stocks and specifically tech stocks?
So we would take a neutral risk stance right now. This is an environment in which we're likely to still see some downside for equities. But I do expect a recovery and the catalyst rebound for stocks. And the catalyst could be a change, a less aggressive path for Western central banks. So we could get to a point where, as I talked about, inflation moderates enough, demand has cooled. And so central banks believe, like the Bank of Canada and the Fed, that they can pursue a less aggressive path later this year in terms of tightening. And I think that could be a catalyst for stocks to rebound. But we definitely want to be cautious. We want to focus on defensives and secular growth in this environment. And of course, technology. The tech sector has exhibited some defensive qualities, especially if you take out, of course, the spec tech area of technology. There are, of course, other areas that are defensive as well. Those could be good performers going forward, good relative performers going forward. The key, though, is to be well diversified, to have exposure to fixed income, to have exposure to equities, to have exposure to alternatives as well, including commodities. We're not about timing the market, but more about having that broad diversification across and within these asset classes. But of course, there are areas that we could tactically overweight. And I would include in that list for equities, China equities, because of the very different conditions in China right now.